Thank you. So, good afternoon, friends, and welcome to the online learning platform at Department of Civil Engineering. I'm Rajesh Gopinath, and I'm your course coordinator for environmental studies. And this comes under the realm of environmental engineering or public health engineering. In today's presentation, okay, we shall be briefly touching upon these aspects. What is environmental science? What are the objectives of, you know, studying this? What do you think is environmental education? What is formal environmental education and what is informal environmental education? What do you understand by the term environmental ethics, environmental crisis? Okay, and most importantly, I'll be brushing you upon the concept of ecocentric view, anthropocentric view. And before I finish my presentation, I will give you a glimpse of the various principles of environmental management. And then once I summarize, I will be providing you the references, which I would humbly request you to pursue further to enhance your knowledge. Okay. Now, whenever we speak about environmental science, we need to understand that we are actually talking about complex, complicated interactions. And these are the interactions which is taking place in the natural world and the man-made world. Okay, I'm talking about interactions which is due to interrelationships. And these are the relationships between the natural environment and the built environment. Obviously, relationships leads to complications, leads to outcomes, leads to consequences. In simple words, you know, any interaction, any relationship has an impact. Now, whether it is positive or negative depends on the type of relationship we are talking about. Okay, and what makes environmental science very interesting is because it's a multidisciplinary component. Okay, you got politics, you got ethics, you got policies, you got economy, you got planning, you got justice. Everything is imbibed in this simple term called as environment. Okay, the interesting part is, you know, earlier in the session when I was asking you about environment, what do you think is your environment? I was just trying to understand the amount of knowledge that you've garnered in your under, you know, probably your school days, because, you know, everyone remembers environment as the, you know, anything that surrounds us. Environment is our surrounding. That's why, you know, when I asked you what is your environment, you said nature, people, and so forth. But you know what I want you to understand is environment is not your surrounding. Okay, environment is your immediate surrounding. Okay, now actually environment comes from a French word, okay, environ, to surround. So if somebody questions me, can you please tell me what is your environment, I will definitely not say the clouds, the mountains, the sky. Okay, not even the tree for a matter, because right now I'm inside my chamber. So my environment is the desk, okay, the air just surrounding me, the chairs, the humans who interact with me. Because, you know, anything which surrounds you in a proximity, anything which is immediately around you, that is capable of having a relationship with you. That is capable of influencing you. All right. So when someone says that my environment is global warming, I would rather say no, it is local warming or urban warming. So my dear friends, you know, throughout this presentation, you will be understanding so many new concepts. Okay, you will be, of course, learning, but I will make you unlearn and I'll also make you relearn. A very simple exercise was when I asked you who invented telephone. So the basic knowledge we had is Sir Alexander Graham Bell, but it's not correct. Okay. Now also what I would do here is I would try to sensitize you people, okay, with respect to the actual environmental facts. There are a lot of myths that we follow. Okay. For instance, you know, whenever there is a festival such as Naga Panchami, okay, I have seen people go and pour milk on the ant hills. First of all, it's an ant hill built by termites. Okay, let's try to understand one thing. Ant hills are built by termites. And secondly, if the snake comes and, you know, resides in an ant hill, it's only because snakes are cold-blooded animals. Okay, and when you go to an anthill, if you go inside that, it's very cool because, you know, probably at, you know, if you go a little more deeper in that area, you'll find groundwater. Okay, so it's a cool place. Snakes can take rest. Now, what is the mistake we do? Snake is not a mammal. You remember I asked you one more question. Tell me the animals that you see in the wild. So somebody said snake. Snake is a reptile. Okay, agreed upon. But snake is not a mammal. Only the mammals drink milk because they have mammary glands. Snake is a reptile. If you give milk to a snake, the snake will die. Okay. So tomorrow I hope that, you know, if you see somebody doing such, you know, a non-environmentally ethically aspect of pouring milk into an anthill, you have to educate them. Tell them what is right and what is wrong. Let me show you a small video to make you understand what is that you're going to see, you know, here on for the next 12 sessions of environmental science. If you cannot listen, it's okay, just watch it.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself,
okay, thank you. I believe that, you know, that video was really inspiring and motivating. Okay, now, as a matter of fact, when we speak about environment, this is what comes to our mind: nature. Okay, but environment studies is not just about nature. You know, when I say nature, probably we are talking about ecosystems, you know, forest ecosystem, desert ecosystem, grassland ecosystem. Or if I come to a macro scale, you know, terrestrial ecosystem, aquatic ecosystem. Now, if I go towards the water, freshwater ecosystem, marine ecosystem. No, it's not just the ecosystems. Also, it is not just talking about natural resources such as water, wind, you know, soil, wildlife. It's also not just talking about the interactions which are there between the wildlife. Okay, it is not just the interaction between the human beings and the natural world. It's also about climate. It's also about weather. Okay, and yes, when it comes to your engineering aspects, you also speak about pollution. Remember I said, when you have interactions, when you have a relationship, there are impacts. The negative impacts is the pollution. So how do you go about controlling the pollution? So what is the objective of studying or understanding rather environmental science? Primarily to improve awareness. Because if we want to manage our planet Earth, the only planet on which life is possible, if we want this to be, you know, restored, protected, we need to improve awareness among all human beings. Okay, I would not say earthlings, human beings. Okay, nextly, you know, it is very necessary that if you do not understand the scientific basis, then it's very difficult to, you know, have a healthy, clean, safe, natural ecosystem. Also, please understand, every human action has dire consequences on environment. And that is something which we need to take care. So only if you, study the subject of environmental studies or environmental science, environmental engineering, okay, then only you'll be able to understand the impact of human actions. And then how do you go about controlling the impacts? Please remember, the most important thing is applying knowledge. So natural intelligence is very important before you go applying it and you speak about artificial intelligence. Okay, if your natural intelligence is not in place, then your artificial intelligence will collapse. Now, how much do you know about environmental education? We know that it is compulsory. You know, you might be feeling awkward. Why do I have to study this subject? I am from, you know, digital branch. I am from computer science. Why do I need to study this? Okay, the fact is, you know, the awareness level among all human beings are so poor that the Supreme Court had to make it mandatory that every undergraduate course of any program must study the subject. Okay, probably it was the Middlebury College of United States of America who actually for the first time prepared the curriculum of environmental science. In India, if you really want to explore, there is a society called as Bombay Natural History Society, BNHS. And they do a lot of activities, you know, which helps to protect environment. Now, as I said, yes. So environment is not a field which is restricted to an environmental engineer like me, but it is open to all. This is our earth and we need to protect it. We need to have knowledge about that. Okay. And please understand, whenever classes are being conducted, you know, whenever a syllabus has been prepared, whenever a test has been carried out, we're all talking about formal education, an organized effort. But unfortunately, this formal education is failing. Okay, because you all are within the four walls and trying to learn environment. To understand environment, you should be in the natural environment. Okay, and see, for instance, if I ask you to look at the images on the screen, the textbook which I wrote the first time, if you sit and study that, I would rather say formal. But you know, if you people also try to, you know, search for a magazine like National Geographic and you start reading that, then I would call it informal education, which is more effective. Okay, now let's move forward. Formal education. So what are the issues? First and foremost, it is compulsory. So how do you take it? Do I take it because I need to pass the exam or do I take it because I need to have attendance? It's the attitude which matters. The second important issue is how updated is your syllabus? Okay, you must actually, you people are lucky because you know the syllabus or the curriculum which has been framed for you is actually updated. But your, the predecessors were eventually sitting and learning the same old subject. What is atmosphere? What is lithosphere? In fact, you know, we are in the era of global warming. The amount of carbon dioxide has gone much beyond the numbers which are still printed in the textbooks. Okay, formal education is only about facts and figures. There is no practical exposure. In fact, you know, whenever I go to a forest with my friends or my team or my eco club members, they learn environmental education better because when they go there, when we go there, okay, we appreciate the environmental assets. All right. Now, I'll just show you one more small video to make you understand of how wrong information is being provided. And these are people who are in position.
ಅದನ್ನ ಉಳಿಸ್ಕೊಂತ ಬಳಸ್ಕೊಂತ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಆಯ್ತಲ್ಲ ಗಿಡಗಳನ್ನೇ ಕಾರ್ಬನ್ ಮೊನಾಕ್ಸೈಡ್ ನ ಹೊರದಾಕಿ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕಾರ್ಬನ್ ಡೈಆಕ್ಸೈಡ್ ಮಾಡೋ ಶಕ್ತಿ ಗಿಡಗಳಿಗಿದವೆ ನಾವು ನ್ಯಾಚುರಲ್ ಆಗಿ ಮಾಡೋಕ್ಕಾಗಲ್ಲ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಮಟ್ಟದಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಮಾಡೋಕ್ಕಾಗಲ್ಲ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಮಟ್ಟದಲ್ಲಿ ಗಿಡಗಳು ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಗಿಡಗಳು ಮಾಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕಂತ ಇವತ್ತು ನಿಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ವಿಶೇಷವಾಗಿ
ಸೊ ದಿಸ್ ಜೆಂಟಲ್ಮ್ಯಾನ್ ಐ ಡೋ ನಾಟ್ ನೋ ಹೂ ಹಿ ಇಸ್ ಬಟ್ ಹಿ ಸೇಸ್ ದಟ್ ದ ಪ್ಲಾಂಟ್ಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ದ ಪೊಟೆನ್ಶಿಯಲ್ ಟು ಕನ್ವರ್ಟ್ ಕಾರ್ಬನ್ ಮೊನಾಕ್ಸೈಡ್ ಟು ಕಾರ್ಬನ್ ಡೈಆಕ್ಸೈಡ್ Let me highlight two mistakes. The first mistake is, it is not plants, it is green plants. Second mistake is, green plants have the potential to you know, not just convert carbon dioxide to oxygen, but the other way as well. Okay, so if information is being provided wrong to you, then how well are you taking the subject? Okay, and now what happens in your formal education? Many ways of delivering the information. Now today when I'm sitting with you across the digital world, this is also formal education. Okay, now, but again the concept is same. Are you here to understand the subject or are you here to pass the subject? If you consider this as a subject that I would like to understand, not learn, trust me, then the actual goal of having environmental education in your degree program is successful. Now, what's informal education? This is where, you know, I take you to a forest or probably I take you for a trek. Okay, you know, we show you some movies. We take you for some field visits. And not just I take you, you people yourself indulge in all these experiences, that is voluntary experiences. Okay, you join some NGOs, you carry out some eco-friendly activities with them. So informal education is when we do things beyond the four walls. We are not restricted to any curriculum. We can learn anything and everything we want. Okay, and trust me, when you do this, you are doing away with the conventional knowledge and you are going to learn that you have never ever come across. And when you do that, you will actually realize that most of the things that you see in this artificial world has been mimicked, copied from nature. Even if it's a bullet train, if it's a solar cooker, okay, even anything for that matter. Okay, I don't know how many of you have seen the movie Mission Impossible, wherein, you know, he did a stunt in Burj Khalifa, or let's say a recent Hindi movie called Tanaji. Okay, there were a lot of similar concepts wherein people had mimicked nature, unfortunately not the correct manner. Now I'll show you one more small video. Okay, another 1 minute or so, just look at it. Look at the precision, look at the beauty of a natural creation. Can this be taught to you in four walls? No. Is this part of your curriculum? No. So this is where, you know, informal education takes you a step forward to learn things. And probably if you're inspired by this, then you will find solutions to so many problems within this human environment. As complex and perfect as this.
If this doesn't get him noticed, nothing will.
So friends, that's again, you know, a platform wherein you can appreciate nature. In fact, you know, if you, when you were kids, probably you had eco clubs or environmental clubs. And if you were part of it, I'm sure you know much more than what I am knowing or what I'm talking. Okay, so this is a glimpse of what all can be done in informal education. As a matter of fact, you know, you can see that some of these activities were carried out by the students of our college itself, you know, when they were part of the eco clubs, you know, let's say plantation drive, sapling drive, treks to Ramnagara, cleaning up the place, Shramdan, okay, trek and photography inside a forest, okay, appreciating, you know, the exhibits. Okay, now what is that we need to understand when it comes to environmental ethics or environmental crisis? Okay, what we need to realize is that the attitude that I and you have, the attitude that the human beings have, is not actually in place, because, you know, we have a human-centric thinking. We believe that, you know, we are the most important creatures on earth and everybody else is inferior to us. Now, this attitude is what is hurting the environment. If you speak about pollution, it's because of this attitude. We need to shift from ego to eco attitude. We need to understand the concept that, you know, every organism around us is important. All right, friends, I'm sorry for that interruption. Okay. So if we can overcome that attitude, then probably it can help us. You know, in fact, I believe that, you know, it was during the first Earth Day that we actually spoke about, you know, the ego-centered approach. In fact, if you're basically looking at the IUCN status, you know, if you look at the screen on your right-hand corner, you will realize that most of the animals, thanks to us, are in critically endangered status, except for one species, which is the human beings, who is least concerned about these. Okay, so it's time for me and you to shift from the ego approach to the eco approach. Okay, now these are simple depictions for us to understand how wrongly we are doing things. Okay, now let's move further. You know, if somebody encroaches our area, how much of pain and hatred and anger and anguish is there inside us? Just imagine when we are doing deforestation rampantly, what's happening? Okay, we have moved towards industrialization, but where is this heading if there's no sustainability in place? Okay, the shift has to happen. You know, when we speak about the human-centered approach, anthropocentric approach, we only speak about, infinite supply of resources. We feel that we are the most superior, and environment is there for us to plunder. That's not correct. Okay, as simple as that, we should understand that all the resources are restricted. They are finite. And if we continue to utilize, exploit, and plunder, there'll be no more resources left for us. Okay, now, I'm almost done with the presentation. My dear friends, these are few of the principles of environmental management. Polluter pays principle, precautionary principle, and not whatnot. Okay, if all of us are able to imbibe, if all of us are able to practice, adopt, okay, then it will actually matter for us. Because if these principles are in place, trust me, my dear friends, we will not see environmental issues that you're seeing today. So let's summarize. So what did we understand in this brief introductory session? We understood that environmental science is not just natural science, it's an applied science. It speaks also about pollution and how to control pollution. It is based on scientific aspects, but derived from natural aspects. It is multidisciplinary, okay? Yes, there are environmental challenges, and these challenges cannot be, handled by just having classes within four walls. You need to also imbibe with informal education. You must have a hunger to learn. Like the macaque you see on the screen, you must have a hunger to learn more. You must keep yourself, updated with what's happening in the present world, okay? We must be environmentally ethical. When you see something which is environmentally not friendly, you must go and educate the people. We must shift from the human-centered approach to eco-centered approach. If we can do all this, then the perspective will be served. My dear friends, these are few of the references that I've gone through to make this presentation. I would humbly request you to also pursue and enhance your knowledge. Okay. Now, this is a textbook which you can also additionally read. And this, of course, is based on your curriculum. The VTU curriculum, what you see, is prepared by me itself. Okay. Now, the next week, that is your first official class that we engage, we shall be talking about ecosystems. We shall try to understand the structure and function, and we shall be restricting, as the curriculum says, on forest, desert, wetlands, riverine, oceanic, and lake ecosystems. So here you'll be learning concepts such as food chain, food web, biogeochemical cycles, and so forth. So my dear friends, I'm done with the presentation, and I humbly thank you for your kind attention. And please remember, you can be the change. You are the person who can make a difference. Corona did make a difference. COVID did make a difference. It actually, resulted in, huge amount of air pollution from being eliminated from this earth. Okay, so we should understand that whatever is happening is due to our actions. You are the person who is going to breathe the next air. Please understand, what you have on this earth is not something which has been passed on from your past, but it is something which you owe to your future. Because, I'm sure most of you are very savvy with digital world, Facebook. Trust me, tomorrow if you have a face app challenge, this is not a good thing that we can see. We have only one planet, and who better to take care of this one planet than you people? Because tomorrow you are the leaders, you are the managers, you are the next environmental crusaders. Okay, so my dear friends, sorry for the technical glitches in the middle, but I'm done with the presentation. Okay, thank you. So if you have queries, I would humbly request you to please let me know.